Hi, this is Tricia from Interviews from the Edge, and I am speaking right now with Roger Miret. Roger, would you like to go ahead and introduce yourself?
Yeah, hi, Tricia. I'm the lead singer for Agnostic Front and Roger Miret of Disasters. And one more, the Alligators. It's a small little side project, but it's way cool. It's really crazy, fast, old school hardcore. Right. But it's a pleasure to speak to you.
Yeah, you've got a new album coming out with the Disasters.
Yeah, January 24th, I think.
That was one of the things I wanted to ask you about, because I did see 25th.
Yeah, I don't know. One of those days.
It's called Gotta Get Up Now?
Yes.
And that's on People Like You, right? That's your new record label?
That's correct. People Like You Records. I did a record for them in Europe with the Disasters called My Riot, which released on Sailor's Grave in America, and People Like You Records in Europe. People Like You Records is part of Century Media. They decided to open up the People Like You side here in the United States, and we're one of the first American offspring.
That's a Century Media company?
Yeah, it's a little division of Century Media. It's the same people, same company. But People Like You is the more rock and roll, more psychobilly rock and roll edge. Century Media is heavier.
My readers should be very familiar with Century Media. It's a name they see often. I did not realize that you guys were part of that. I will tell you something really interesting. I think you'll find it interesting anyway, speaking of Century Media. I just talked to Johnny Plague, the lead singer from Winds of Plague.
Right.
They're on Century Media just a few weeks ago. And I asked him about who influenced them, because, you know, they're kids. They're on their third album. They came out of high school. And he was talking about his East Coast influences. Sick of It All, Madball, H2O. It was amazing to me that these kids even know who those bands are. They're from California. These are East Coast bands. That's your group. That's you guys.
Right. Well, you know, we've been spreading these words for a long time, you know? It's cool that across generation over generation, I've been in Agnostic Front for 3 decades, and it's cool that, you know, it's music for youth. It's always been rebellious music. It's always been about overcoming oppression. And you can feel it, the energy, it's alive, no matter what. And you can put on our first album, Victim and Pain, for instance, came out in 1984. Yeah. Put it on 40, 50 years from now, and somebody will still feel the same way, and it's still going to have that outburst of energy. It's still going to be that insanity that started New York hardcore, you know? It's timeless.
It was so hard to break out of that New York scene. I talked to, like, Anthrax and Slayer. I've done a couple of interviews with a couple of the guys from Slayer, just talking about, you know, being amazed that, you know, this many years later, thrash and hardcore still going so strong, hearing kids coming out of high school, knowing the bands that I knew from the East Coast just because I lived on the East Coast and I traveled. I grew up in Maryland and used to go to New York, you know, CBGBs and everything where you guys played. You know, so they're familiar names to me, but who'd have thunk it? These kids, you're still their idol.
It's cool. I mean, I'm grateful. I'm grateful and honored that the youth of today still are so into such classic bands like ourselves, Slayer, Anthrax. So these bands that you've mentioned, these are bands that we didn't know we were creating a movement ourselves. We were just enjoying the time, and we were all rebellious kids speaking out of some sort, some way through our music. And it stood the test of times. The bands themselves have stood the test of time. And like I say, it's a timeless piece. And I'm glad it's still there. I think I'll always be attached to it somehow. I mean, you know, I think that's just how that music speaks to people.
Well, it excites me very much when I hear them say that name. And I know I get to link it in an article from a brand new band. It keeps the name out there. People, you know, in California that are fans of Winds of Plague that have never heard of Sick of It All, they get a chance to look that up and check it out.
Absolutely.
You know?
That's the way it used to be. When I would find a band that I loved, when I went to a little mom and pop record store when I was a kid, and I loved the record, I would look at their thank list, and I would buy all the bands they thanked and then check them out. That's how we started finding and discovering. Well, we didn't have the internet back then.
Mm-hmm.
Now the internet's there, so the world's really at your fingertips. Back then, we had to do all the groundwork literally by reading and by sending an envelope, a letter to your favorite band, and they would tell you what bands they like and what to look out for. It was really cool, you know? And now it's so much easier, but it's cool that people are starting to recognize and give appreciation to, you know, legends and bands that have been doing this for so long.
Yeah, and you guys are actually probably more popular now than you ever were before, thanks to the internet. You can go into a little town and they know who you are, you know?
Yeah, I guess. With the ugly guys coming in to make ugly music, that's That's us.
Terry King said something about that, too. We were talking about the fact that we bought records based on cover art because you never really knew. You know, there was no internet. There was no way to know if something was going to suck or be good. He said you had to look for the gems and use the European mags as kind of a guide.
Yeah, you really looked up to all these publications. And, I mean, it was cool. It was kind of cool. It's kind of like discovering treasure, unwrapping stuff. And, you know, it's either gold or copper, if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. It had that feeling. It was that really cool. They're really cool feeling. I don't know how to explain it, but it was cool.
Where are you at right now?
I live in Arizona right now. I live in Scottsdale, Arizona. I'm home right now with the kids, just enjoying a little bit of family time. I'm having a lot of fun with my kids. You know, they're young. Avi is 3.5 years old, and Desi is 1.5 years old. Mm-hmm. I'm here raising a family. My oldest daughter, Nadia, is 23 years old. You know, so it's a big gap. But I'm enjoying it. I've always loved kids, and I'm really enjoying it.
You're always such a wild man. And you've done nothing but travel and tour. God, since the 80s. I mean, I'm surprised you had time to even have kids and have a family. But you've been through some tough times, too. And, I mean, you did your stint in jail. You were having your drug problems. And you guys were on the road all the time. And now to find out you got a 3-year-old and a 1.5-year-old. And you're a family man.
Yeah, well, I grew up growing up.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, you know, not really. I mean, family's always been something that's really important to me. The whole time, all that stuff you were saying, I was a father back then, too, you know? Like, when I did my stint, I did my jail time, and through all that, I always had Nadia, but like, when she was only 1.5 years when I happened to do my last state incarceration, and that was really hard on her. I mean, it was hard on me, too. It was kind of sad to see her go through that because she didn't understand. She didn't know why I couldn't go home with her. She got older, too. That really, like, you know, kind of woke me up, and that was really awakening for myself in general. I'm like, what am I doing? I'm hurting the people I love, and ever since that, it's been out of trouble and get a grip on life, you know?
That was in the 90s.
Yeah, that was 1989.
While you were in there, you were writing. You were writing music. Seems like you were writing music your whole life, huh?
Yeah, I can't stop. I mean, someday I think of something to think about. Maybe she just put out a book about all the songs I wrote, and that should be enough. Between all the bands, between Agnostic Front and Disasters. I mean, the other day I was sitting here counting all the albums I've done, like my records on albums.
Mm-hmm.
There's, I think I was somewhere at 16. That's a lot.
Yeah. Well, and the other thing is, Agnostic Front, you guys broke up for a good 5 years or so and still had so many albums. I mean, you were punching them out.
Yeah, well, we didn't really break up. We just took a leave of absence because I decided to, you know, I kind of wanted to go to, I was a Harley Davidson mechanic and I wanted to get into the dealerships. So I wanted to go to Harley Davidson school. So I took a break to finish that just to get my life together for my family, for my daughter. She was getting older.
Mm-hmm.
So when I'm home, because it's kind of hard being on the road and coming home and finding all this crazy work and it doesn't pay the bills.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a little leave of absence we took, and as soon as that was over, I got into the shops, and some things didn't work out, blah, blah, blah. Then I had asked my daughter, Nadia, permission to go back into the band and hit it again. She said, yeah. Mm-hmm. If she would have said no, I probably wouldn't have done it, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. And then I got back into it, you know? And that was about 3 years. You're right. And that was like, let me see, 1992 to about 5 years. You're right, 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, I think 97 you came back.
Yeah, exactly.
Back.
It was 92 when that happened.
Yeah, because the last album you put out, Last Warning?
Yeah, it's funny. All three of our live albums are off the TV. So that was the second one, Last Warning.
Stigma did not like that album, Last Warning?
I don't know what he likes, what he doesn't like. He's a strange character.
You're like, you ask him.
He loves the new one. He's insanely in love with the brand new one. So am I. It's a great record. It's coming out soon.
Yeah. Yeah, you've got so much going on. You've got the new album coming out with the Disasters. You're going to be touring in support of that. You've already got dates set up to go out with the Agnostic Front again. You guys are going to be hitting Europe, right, early in the year?
Yeah. Actually, we're going to be hitting the West Coast in, I think it's April. We're going to do some dates on the West Coast and into the West, like Nevada, Colorado, Texas, and California, Arizona. We're getting that as early as April, and before we go to Europe, and then we'll come back with it to the East Coast.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll make sure I put up the link so that people can check out the tours and see where you guys are going to be, so when you're near them, they can come out and see you.
That's great.
Yeah, for
well,
both bands.
I'm going out right now in February. February 2nd, I go out with Matt Senior from Ranch's band, Devil's Brigade. I do a little stint here again on the West Coast, just 12 dates.
Okay.
That's a little teaser out here. I guess I'll start all the teasers out here, then I'll head out east.
Yeah, that makes sense. Especially during the winter. It's better to stay near home where it's warm. In the East Coast, you know. I'm sure you don't miss the winter time on the East Coast at all, huh?
I don't miss it at all.
Okay, I wanted to ask you one thing about the new album, the Disasters album, Gotta Get Up Now. Will you tell me a little bit about the production of the new album?
It was recorded in two different places, in Phoenix and in Houston, Texas. Partially because the band split between both areas, mm-hmm. and it's four different recordings, completely different recordings, with two different drummers mm-hmm. and two different bass players, and then the last recording with an addition with a top player. So it's amazing that it all sounds like it was recorded in one place. And it's really insane, but I'm really happy with the way it came out, considering the guy who had to mix it had a nightmare to deal with.
Yeah, I bet.
Great job. Byron did a great job mixing the record. It's consistent, sound, it was all done in one place mm-hmm. by the same people. And it's pretty cool. You know, Johnny Real, original bass player, he plays with the Street Dogs, mm-hmm. Played on the record, produced the record, and then Roy, our bass player, just heard the tracks and was like, you know what, he played everything I would play, it's no big deal. Mm-hmm. And he had played in all the songs in the record, so it didn't matter. It's a you know, we're all friends here. We're all past disasters or current disasters. So it doesn't matter. We all work with each other. It's cool.
You mean that literally am band related?
Yeah, even with the new Agnostic Front record, mm-hmm. like, we have Matt Henderson contributing to a song, who's our top player from the One Voice era. Mm-hmm. We have Steve Gallo, our last drummer, contribute two songs. I mean, family's family. Once you're in a family, once you're in a network of Agnostic Front or Disasters, there's always contributions from past members, and it's always cool, because, you know, once you're in, you're always in, you're never out, you know?
How are you doing your songwriting now? I mean, are you guys creating digital media? Are you sending it back and forth? Or are you guys writing individually and then getting together to
Well, that's pretty much what happens. There's a lot of individual writing, and then they get together, and they put their songs down on the table, and then everybody adds a creative part or change whatever, mm-hmm. and it goes from there. And that's the same way writing process for both bands, being that I live in Arizona and the rest of these guys in Agnostic Front, New York. Mm-hmm. The same thing with the Disasters. The three guys are in Phoenix, one guy's here with me, and then with the Alligators, the other three guys are in California. So it's basically a lot of internet, like, hey, check out the song,
yeah.
and then we walk from there.
That's cool. So I bet none of them start off like they, or end up like they started off, huh?
Well, unless we're all together and in a room, nothing's really been like that in a while. Mm-hmm. Only because, you know, I live here, it's kind of hard, but, you know.
Yeah.
When we let the songs mature, then we don't just say, okay, this is it. We actually rehearse them a lot and change a lot of things,
yeah.
and the songs do change. Nothing, rarely anything stays exactly the way it is from the minute it was presented by one guy. It's played a lot of times and then changed. I mean, a lot. So it's cool.
Roger, I wanted to thank you so much for joining me today.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for everyone for listening, and I greatly appreciate it.
Okay, and you have a great holiday.
Thank you.
Okay.